thing. So awesome, awesome. So welcome, welcome everybody. This is the third attempt we've tried to do this today, and you were painting and you, yeah. I said, look, is it on today? So thanks for coming on. I know it's late, but sometimes, you know, people are still around at this time of the night, but we are doing it. So Luann here from Goddess on Purpose, and I think this is about our fifth person I've had the pleasure of interviewing, the Way of the Gifted Goddess series, where I get to speak to inspiring people like yourself, Karen, about their stories, about their learnings, and I want to share it with my community. And so I'm really honoured to have you tonight. The author of this amazing book that I could not put down, sorry about the light there, Shame, Guilt and Surviving, Martin Bryant. And before I just bring you on, I'm just going to read your bio, if I can, right? I'm going to do it all right. So, Martin Bryant will always be connected to a great deal of misery, torment, and death, but it didn't start on April 28th, 1996. My God, that was so long ago now. The day he murdered 35 people during the Port Arthur massacre in Tasmania, Australia. So I know people were international, and we'll get to that part of that story later if they didn't hear about that, but I'm sure they did. But this book just isn't about Martin Bryant. It is one woman's story of how child abuse, trauma, and dysfunctional parents made her the perfect candidate for Martin Bryant's unwanted attention long before the massacre of 1996. How did devastating childhood traumas affect this woman's ability to demand help, to speak, to yell as loudly as she could until something was done to stop his violent stalking of her? Could the massacre have been averted had the laws around stalking supported rather than limited police response to her cries for help? What was Martin Bryant like before the massacre? And following the journey of Karen Collier, one of Martin Bryant's invisible victims, as she does her best to describe life before, during, and after Martin Bryant entered her life. And Karen's lessons in the power of words began with writing for Australian radio in the early 1990s, shut down by her father, then by Martin Bryant. Karen had help from great mentors and professional writing and editing skills that helped keep the words flowing. Setting free her true voice unleashed Karen's great passion to help others find their voice and to make it clear and loud. And so welcome, Karen. Welcome, welcome. And I tell you what, and I know that I've heard this when I put a little post out on Facebook when I first read it, and I was going to Adelaide for the weekend, and on the plane, I've had it for a little while, but I don't know if I had the courage to read it, but I knew that was the time. I just went, I've got this time to myself, and I could not put it down. Like, we got off the plane and I was in the hotel room still finishing it. It really, really spoke to me, and it was just I was just blown away by your writing, your vulnerability, the way you tell your story, and I felt like I was there the whole time with you. A couple of the people in the book you were talked about, I'm like, I really wanted to, I don't know, I could feel myself going, look, I really wanted to come to your aid. Do you know what I mean? It was like, I was so affected by it. And then the beautiful way, especially about your father, which I want you to share later, how everything kind of turned around and these beautiful lessons that you learned from all of this, which, yeah. But this is not about me speaking, it's all about you, because I just want to get your story out to as many. And it really, yeah, shame and guilt, massive, all right, massive.
Yeah.
Just want to take off my hat to you for sharing this. So first of all, can you tell us a little bit about you and your work, and then how did you get to start being such this prolific writer and published author?
Well, writing's an interesting thing. A lot of people think that the only form of writing is writing a book. That's one form. Every time you write a Facebook post, you're communicating with someone, you're writing it. Instagram, all of the social media, the people who are really kicking goals with that are people who understand how to write. So if you think I can't write a book, that's too big a project, think again, you're writing every day. have a look at what you're actually expressing and doing. So that got me excited about writing again, just playing with social media. And then I did the Groover training, their mastery program with Rachel Jane and Data Groover. And part of that was going to Hawaii to do a writing retreat, which my partner Vicky signed me up for that. And I was a bit annoyed, actually. At the time I said, oh, we can't afford that. I'm not doing that. What a joke. No, not going. Because the natural human thing, when you know you really need to do something, is quite often to resist. Yeah. And find reasons and excuses why you shouldn't do it. So I gave that a red hot go. Yeah. Anyway,
the resistance.
I had a passport, I had no excuse, and she paid, I had no excuse for not going in the end. Yeah. So off I went. And I decided what I was going to write was a book about talking cats and dogs, because I also do animal whispering.
Yes.
And I thought that'd be a lot of fun, very cute, you know, no stress. But of course, it was an intuitive writing course with Tom Bird using his process, which is all about letting the book that's within you write itself, not what you think you want to write. So, of course, what came out was Shame, Guilt and Survival, Martin Bryant. And yeah, I wasn't too happy about that. I was very, I protested a lot at the time, and I just said, I can't do that. There's no way. I don't want to go there. I don't want to do it. I don't want to re-experience all of that by writing it. But every time I sat down to write, more came out. So it soon became very clear to me that if I wish to enjoy writing again and to write other things just for the fun of it, I had to first allow this book to write itself. Does that make sense?
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I had the pleasure of meeting you during at those times. And when we first, you and you're so passionate about animals, and I want to get to that eventually too. But that's what, yeah, my experience of you was you're this amazing intuitive animal whisperer. You can actually speak to animals, and you've got the sanctuary. And then I knew you went to Hawaii, and then boom, out came this book. So do you think that your soul wanted you to write this book at that particular time?
At the time, absolutely. Nothing else would come out. That was every time I sat down to write, more came out, and things that I hadn't even remembered for decades. So it was a bit of a shock through the process. It wasn't fun, but it was cathartic on a grand scale, an incredibly healing experience. As a natural therapist, I've done a lot of study and learned a lot of different therapies, which in the learning you practice on yourself, and you have to actually go through those therapies yourself and allow the processes, which really were the perfect background. So by the time I got to this retreat with Tom Bird, you might call it divine timing, I was ready. Even though I was protesting, I was also ready. I protested, but I still did it. I still knew I had to, and deep down I knew that I could.
So, I loved it. But how did you manage to do it? Like, I could just imagine you were there and you thinking, okay, I'm just going to write about my animals, and then boom. And it's such an emotional topic. And so were there tears? Were you just walked out of the room, or did you just stay with the process and write? Because did you handwrite? You had to handwrite there, didn't you?
Or I can't handwrite for very long. My hand turns into the human claw. So I took my laptop and I type about 90 words a minute. So I was never going to handwrite it because I can't keep up with what's flowing. Yes. I did leave the room a few times, and luckily for me, our beautiful friends Paul Gray and Lorraine Hall were there with Vicky and I as well. And every time I left the room in a state and said, no, I can't do this, Paul just appeared. And he has quite a story of his own to tell, and he understood, you know, he's one of those people that I don't need to use language with, you know, we can just communicate and we get it. So having that understanding there, and of course Vicky didn't really leave my side through that process either, and having actually really the whole room, it was just incredible. The whole experience was amazing, which, like, spiritually speaking, I feel like that's where we're at the moment, where it's not so much the solo journey anymore and the me, it's about community. It's about really working with other people and helping each other rather than being isolated.
Yeah, absolutely. And just reading it, like I said, I couldn't put it down. And I just remembered, I think you opened it with the wide-eyed girl. Or there, that was right at the beginning, and you're talking about, you know, you as this younger, this little girl, really, and yeah. It just, I mean, I can't, well, it didn't break my heart, but it kind of did. Do you know what I mean? I was just drawn in, and then it just started to unravel. And for me, like, these were things I never knew about you, right? I mean, Not all the abuse and all that, but just the rate, you know, you worked. I remember you talking about you were a radio presenter, and then all these other jobs you did, and then moved to Melbourne, and what a journey. And I could see part of myself in there. You know, I could definitely see part of myself, whereas a lot of people who are reading this book can see as well. So, you know, did you write it from I know you were so brave in writing it, but did you do it? Could you say you did it for other people, or was it totally for you?
The writing really was a pretty undemocratic process. Mm. It really just had to come out, and it did. Mm. The decision to publish, that's where it comes into, am I doing this for myself, or am I doing it for other people? Because it would have been very easy not to publish. Mm. And I had moments where I really came close to not publishing it, to going, you know what, I don't need to do this. Again, I felt I was going to be shamed or embarrassed or punished for putting it out there. So I soon understood that that was a big part of the therapeutic process of the book as well. Mm. The really important part was actually owning it.
Yeah.
Writing it was one part, but actually saying, yeah, this is me, I experienced that, and it's okay. That was really important. And I couldn't do that if I just left it sitting on the laptop and never did anything with it, or printed a box of books and just sat them in the garage.
Yeah.
In doing so, then you've robbed yourself of a huge part of that healing process. So, And what you were just saying about recognizing aspects of yourself in there as you read, it's not the... In some ways, it's not even the detail. It almost doesn't matter what my experience was or what happened to me. In each of our lives, we see aspects of ourselves, things that we thought we couldn't survive, or things that we feel ashamed of, that we handled badly and wish we'd done differently. So when we write, we give other people the opportunity to see aspects of themselves, and in doing so, have some healing themselves. And pre-publishing, I had a few people, let a few people read the book. I say let because I was very nervous about it. Mm. I was like, but they really wanted to, which really was an honour. And they all gave very similar feedback, which was, this was really powerful. It gave me a real sense of hope. And I saw myself in there, in different parts of things, in different aspects. So I think that was when I realised I really did have to go ahead and publish, because it was useful, it was good for other people. It wasn't, at that point, it was no longer just my healing process.
Yeah.
It was a healing process for other people. And I figure if you need something that's in that book, yeah, you'll read the book, something will guide you towards reading it.
Absolutely. And that's what I thought when I was, you know, I had it and I'm just going, no, I need... Not that I needed to be in a special place, or I just knew that I would do it, and I wouldn't put it down. You know, I was ready, and I was ready. You know, it wasn't a big thing, but I thought, oh, this is fabulous. So, and some of the people are still alive in this book, right? Your father's still alive. And so, I don't know, that's not on my questions here, but how do you write something about somebody who's still living? And you know, you were very open with what happened during growing up, and then you had this, I don't want to give it away, right, but I do, like, I just felt this big healing, and I found myself going, like, oh, he should still be pain, you know, I had this moment of, And then I went, oh, she's such a forgiving, you know, there's such forgiveness. And for him, you know, he went through his own journey. You almost, you showed us his humanness as well, which of course there is. But yeah, how do you write something? Did he see this? Has he read this? Or
It's a really interesting question, because if I'd planned to write it, I probably would have written it in first person.
Right.
And to be blunt, it probably would have sucked big time.
Okay.
You wouldn't be sitting here interviewing me. You wouldn't even want to read it. I mean, I had a go years ago, and it was awful because it was first person, and I was still a victim.
Mm-hmm.
So it would have come in a for me perspective.
Yes,
so,
totally.
You know, it's taken years of learning all the things, processes that I use when I work with clients myself to understand. Bloody hell, I've lived all my life as a victim, a professional victim, and I was really good at it. And in that space, everything happens in your perception to you. There's no responsibility taken by you for what's going on. It's all, this happened and I had to do that because, you know, which I totally get, because that was me.
Yeah.
So before I could write, it had that. That had to go. I had to actually turn that corner and be able to witness and acknowledge that about myself and not need to do that anymore. And then it came out in third person, so no one got named. I didn't even name myself, really, apart from in the title, you know, on the cover of the book. So,
yeah.
Which wasn't planned. It's literally just how that's how it came out. It came out in that third person. And my parents are both deceased, so neither of them have to read it, which, would I want them to read it? I'm not sure. Mm. You know, people have said to me some pretty awful things like, oh, your mother was a nut job, your father's an asshole. I can see why they might say that, I get it, but they weren't. They were flawed human beings, just like me, just like everybody.
Oh, yes. And that was, you just went along this journey and reading it from, like, there was compassion and then was anger and then there was, you know, there was all different emotions. You took us on a ride, but you didn't come from a place of victim at all. Like, you just came from a, so actually, just before I go, so can you explain the first, when you write something in the first person and the third person, do you write in the second person? No, it's just first or third, is it?
Yeah.
Just for the people who might go, oh, what is she talking about?
First person would be, I ran down the street, I saw this, I felt this, so there's a lot of I in there. And even if I'd thought about it, I wouldn't want that.
Right.
I think because then it becomes all about me, and in some way to me, when I read it, I don't feel like it is. All about me.
Yes.
It's more like something that you could, while you're reading, it's more like you're able to observe it.
Yes. So that's the third person, you're kind of observing, and you were talking about the wide-eyed girl and...
Yeah.
Do you use she a lot? Like, I'm just trying to... So she...
Yeah.
Right, okay. And
it's a bit like, for me, that third person is a little bit like when you're watching television. And you're watching what's happening and you're watching what the different people are doing in the drama, and there's no one sitting there, there's no talking head going, I think, I feel, I do.
Yeah.
None of that's there. Yeah. And the people who do that and do it well, brilliant.
Yeah.
I'm not one of those people.
Yeah.
You got to know what your strength is, I think.
But then if it's in third person, that, like, for the reader, and now I'm just kind of, I don't know, it's like, well, oh, okay, so I'm watching the story, and then does that make one kind of relate more to it, or I don't know, but is that kind of what happens?
That's a really good question. For this one, I think it did.
Yeah.
But I work as an editor as well, mainly doing other people's memoirs. And a lot of them are written in the first person, and written well in the first person, they'll take you on that journey too. It's just as effective when it's really well written. Yeah. So really it depends on the writer and what suits them when they're writing.
Yeah. So you would call this a memoir? Is that, this is a memoir? Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, because that was really awesome to read a book where, you know, a lot of self-help books, not that this is a self, it's a memoir. It's like, okay, here's the story, and then they go, and then there's three ways through that. Do you know what? There's three activities to do, and you must journal, but it wasn't like that. That's, I just was like, yeah, and you still got the healing and the story from that. So I love that. So, wow. So let's talk about the word shame and guilt.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So why did you, tell me first why you called the book this, and then what's your relationship to these words, shame and guilt?
Well,
which everybody has, by the way. Like I'm like, oh wow, this is a book for everybody, and how you dealt with it, and then how I deal with my shame and guilt. You know, I was like, oh god, yeah.
I think that even before I studied radio and was working in media, growing up, I always felt different. Always felt like I was different to everyone else because they didn't know the horrible things that I knew. I mean, as a kid, you don't know what other, you know, you're pretty egocentric and you don't know what other people are experiencing or what they're carrying either. But there was a lot of feeling ashamed, a lot of feeling like you weren't as I don't know, just different. And the feelings of shame that come from sexual assault as a child are horrific. Well, they were for me. I mean, I can't speak for everybody. We're all different. We all respond differently. Mm-hmm. But for me, it just made me feel very ashamed, very, made me feel like I didn't fit into my family of origin. From that moment onwards, everything was different. There was no place of belonging anymore. There was no place of just being normal. That was all gone. So that was had a really big impact on so many areas of life, but it was all tucked under the surface. It was just hidden away. Guilt comes from a lot of the decisions, making poor decisions, relationship decisions, that really, the early experiences made it difficult to understand what a good relationship looked like. Mm. How do people behave in a good relationship? What is good communication? And now I would say to you, and you use the word yourself, it's vulnerability. It's being willing to be open, to be true, and to be vulnerable. But, you know, up until recent years, I would have said I was all those things, but I absolutely wasn't. It was I was very protective. That makes it very difficult to maintain friendships, relationships. You can only go to a certain point. Mm. So there's that aspect of, oh gosh, I wish I'd behaved, you know, differently then or there, or oh, that was a bit harsh. Sorry about that.
Yeah, I get it. I so get it. And then
also, it's hard to put into words. It's a very emotive.
Yeah. Because who taught us how to be in relationship, right? Who taught us how?
Like, yeah.
And it's not like, oh, it's okay, you know, we can't be the black. We don't blame us for that. But there's some decisions that we could have made differently, but then there's also a lot of conditioning in here as well. And have you let yourself off the hook for the guilt and the shame? I'm sure you have. You've written about it, but do you know it takes a long time to do that? Or does the awareness just come one day and you go, shit, I've got to deal with the shame and guilt now? All right, how do I go about that?
I thought I'd cleared most of it.
Yes.
I was surprised how much raised its head while I was writing the book. But again, that was great because I was able to look at it, not feel bad about the fact that it was there, but actually explore how it affects how I deal with people now, decisions I make. And I could also see big differences, and that was exciting.
Yeah. I remember seeing you, I think it was this year, a few months ago at an event, and I hadn't seen you physically for a long time, and you were just radiating. Like something had flipped to, and I just take my eyes off you. You were very magnetic. You were so open, and not that you weren't before, but it just was at a different level. So I'm guessing, yeah it was totally, and I'm sure people told you that when they saw you. But like, even I was talking to Denise and we were just watching you walk across the, you know, and I'm going, well, like, what's happened? And, you know, I'm guessing, you know, shame and guilt, it's so heavy. And if you're holding that, and even though we've done a lot of work and you hold, but you still must be exhausting holding it all in. Well, that is for me, was, well, yeah. You know, and it's the little things, right?
Yes, I had like chronic fatigue for more than a decade. Yeah. Because it is really takes a lot of energy to keep all that squashed down and be chirpy and happy and, you know, all of that, you know, those expectations. So living without it is great. It's like the bird out of the cage, really. It's just a bit of a it's that sense of freedom. It's like you're actually free to just be and no longer worry what people think, no longer worry about whether or not people are judging you or think you're stupid or smart or fat or thin or whatever it is. All of that just kind of has dropped off by the wayside. It's not there. And it's amazing. I didn't know that I could ever actually achieve that level of comfort, not just with myself but with other people as well. So now I can walk into a room and I can just talk to people and it's really easy. Yeah. I'm not uncomfortable. I'm not having to think about what I might say or how to respond to them, or I'm just able to be. And it's, it allows for a deeper connection with people. Yeah. I find that I'm getting better able to really know people because they're able to better know me as well. So it has that lovely flow-on effect as well.
Yeah, sure. Oh, wow. So, just getting back to my God, there's so much kind of coming up here. So maybe I'll just go back back to question four. So for those who may, you know, may be watching or maybe watching the recording later on or listening to the interview, but have not heard of Martin Bryant, I don't even want to say his name, but it's kind of like that. But you know, and it's in the book, I know that, but it's like he was talking you for years before you actually murdered all those people, right?
Yeah.
And he caused so much trauma and hurt, and you know, I was so deeply angered when the police couldn't help you. It was more or less saying, and you know, I was thinking about a lot of abused women and a lot of people who are being stalked. It's like until they actually physically kill you or do, you know, something that people can see, that they can't help you, right?
It's so, I've had responses from people who want to go on police taking and that kind of thing, and I'm like, they're not the issue. The police are fine. They're doing in fact, I think they're incredible human beings. They go out and do something I wouldn't want to do, and most of us don't want to do. They put their lives on the line to protect, serve and protect, but they're hamstrung by shit laws that don't protect us, that don't really protect the vulnerable. So it's not about having a go at the police at all. If anything, I applaud them. What I don't applaud is the draconian laws that we have in Australia and the fact that they still suck.
Yes.
You know, people are still dying. And it's not just women. Men are dying too. Men are being abused. Yes. Men suffer, you know, every day from domestic abuse and violence as well. So as long as we have laws that don't protect those of us who stick our heads up and say, hey, this is happening, I need help. Nothing's changed.
Yeah. And like even if you, because I don't know if you couldn't even get an intervention order or anything.
No, I didn't know his name until after the massacre itself, when the police finally confirmed it. I mean, intuitively I knew, but I had to wait to actually get the evidence to get the proof. I gave them things. I had things like his description of his car, descriptions of him, descriptions of his license plate, recordings of his voice. I had all sorts of things, none of which I kept because after years of trying to get help, I gave up in frustration.
Yeah.
I just I mean, I could never have known what the outcome was going to be, but even if I did, I couldn't have changed it. Obviously, it is what it is. But for those, for anyone who's caught up in that, you know, it's really not good enough. Mm. And we the people really need to look at ourselves as well, because we vote.
Yes.
And even if you say, well, I didn't vote for the people who are currently in government, and I certainly could say that, we have a voice. We have social media. We have newspapers. We have the ability to stand on a footpath with a placard. We have the ability to make noise and get other people to make noise with us. So, you know, there's always room to do something. You'd think that might be my passion after all of that. That's not my driving force, though. But
tell us, what is your driving force?
My driving force is animal rescue, as you know, rescuing. I'm very passionate about greyhounds. I have 3 rescued greyhounds, 2 from Brightside Farm Sanctuary here in Tassie, who does an incredible job, and currently fostering kittens, so feeding orphaned tiny little neonate kittens. That's a lot of fun. Yeah. And we've got pigs, chooks, roosters. Neighbours aren't too keen on the roosters. They actually came and took 7 of them away to a farm somewhere else.
Oh, my goodness.
They found someone else who wanted pet roosters, so they didn't have to listen to them. So that made it very clear to us that we need to find a bigger space where we could actually set up sanctuary. We call it Rainbow Animal Sanctuary. We're currently, we've got the house on the market, and we're looking for a place where we've got a smaller house and a lot more land so that the neighbours don't feel the need to rehome our roosters.
Oh, okay, right. We was like that. Wow. And then I'm sure, and Vicky's your partner, so you're both on the set, like doing all this work with the animals.
Yeah. Oh. And the animals work with people too, like our greyhounds and our cats quite often make their presence known and come in and work with clients when we're working on a therapeutic basis as well. So I'm really looking forward to having a space where animals and people can come together more, and people can learn more about these beautiful sentient beings and who they really are, rather than just a dog or, you know.
Yeah, Dan, I remember, I think it was you were talking one day about, and my dog Nala, well, no, we're totally off the subject here, but, and she was really itchy or something. You said, well, no, look at her food, or you said something, yeah. That's in the food. So I actually went and changed her, for she doesn't have any wheat or anything like that, and it's gone, yeah. it's all gone. So I went, thank you very much, Karen.
They do talk, it's just that most people don't realise they can hear them. Mm. And a lot of behaviours in animals can come down to something in the environment that's really easily remedied. Mm. If you understand that's what they're telling you.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of animals are very sensitive to detergents and some of the chemicals that we use to wash our clothes and their bedding. Yeah. So, you know, an itchy dog's not a happy dog. It's not going to behave the way you want it to behave. It's, you know, it's like having chronic eczema and everyone's expecting you to feel really good.
Yeah,
like, I'm not good. I'm itchy.
I'm
cranky.
Wow. So, and I'm going to put up the links to your Rainbow Sanctuary and to your where we can find your book as well. So, I just want to ask you, like, coming back to the shame and guilt. I know we kind of touched on it, but how can each of us move through, like, in your experience? Shame and you know, it's, we all have it, but what would your advice be to somebody who's, I mean, first of all, do they know it's shame and guilt that's holding, you know, keeping them closed, or but if they knew it was, like, what would you advise them to do?
Well, a lot of what you're talking about is quite often held very deeply in the energy system and in the subconscious. So it's not necessarily something that you're fully aware of, but you know that certain situations will trigger you into emotional responses that can seem a bit strong for the situation. You might have fears that you don't want to address. You might not. There are certain situations you don't want to go into, like some people avoid going out socially. All sorts of things, all sorts of triggers. You might have trouble in your relationship and not understand why you're not really able to relate. So there's not just one. For me, it's not just been one therapy that has fixed everything. There's no one fix it all. It's not like you can take a pill and go, thanks very much, job done. Yeah. It's making a determined effort to go out and find therapists who you can work with, who can help you. We use techniques called one called NET, Neuroemotional Technique, which is where we go and find the emotion where it's trapped in the body. Yeah. And you don't even need to know what it is, but we can find it and we can tell you. Yeah. We use psychosomatic therapy, and that's where that's a lot of fun. You do hand reading, so you understand about how the physical body tells us and educates us about who you are.
Yes.
Who Luanne is. Yeah. If I sat with you for less than an hour, really, I could do a body reading with you. I could read your face, your hands, your physical body, not just the shape, but the nature of the tissue, where the tissue sits, where how it sits, how your posture would indicate a lot about your history, what you might have experienced, where you're trying to protect yourself, where you're trying to cover up. So that is all a big part of that therapy, is also learning how to physically release the memories from the body. So a lot of it comes to releasing memories from the body. The writing process also does that. That's another part of it too. So as much as anything, just get started. Just get started. And if the first therapy doesn't do much for you, or you're not ready for it, or you don't like the therapist, or that's okay. Find another one.
Yeah.
Keep looking. And talk to people like yourself, or talk to your people who have started down that healing road, and get recommendations from them and see who they've been to see. But just get started.
Yeah, definitely. Don't be scared. I think a lot of people may be scared, I don't know about myself probably, of opening Pandora's box, right? Like, once you let that lid off, and it depends what it is, but it's like, I don't know if it necessarily happens like that. Sometimes it just comes out slowly bubbling and then comes over, and then you have the explosion. And I don't know, it feels like a sleeping volcano, but just do the work.
It varies, doesn't it? Some things come out like a volcano, and other things it's this gentle, slow process. But I found too, a big part of my first training I ever did was actually with Vicky years ago. It was the psychosomatics. And part of that was learning how to do the psychosomatic emotional release massage. And that was profound in the early days for me, that physical touch, because I wasn't really used to physical touch, hadn't grown up with it. You know, for me, physical touch was something that could quite often mean something horrible was coming my way. So, you know, I didn't really welcome it. And then I went and did kahuna massage training with Mette's retreat in Kinkin in Queensland. Yeah. And I recommend those two therapies to anybody.
Yeah.
Male or female, just beautiful. Learning to, particularly for those of us who have had been assaulted physically in some way, learning to be comfortable and feel safe in that group situation in my own physical body. And in a completely non-sexual way was incredible.
Yeah, I love that. And I'm very similar to you. Like, I didn't get my first massage until I was about 35. I'm like, no, I don't need that. No, even with women. And then when I had to take that fear away and deal with why I didn't do that. And now it's like, yes, please, come on, give it. But yeah, it's this little thing you don't realise. And even when I'm talking about shame and guilt, it can be just as much as and mean the same. I remember when I came back from the US and I separated from my ex-husband back then. You know, it's kind of like, oh God, there's shame. Like, I can't keep a marriage together, and there's guilt that I had to leave. I wanted to leave, and I did get some therapy through this amazing guy. He lived off the grid somewhere, and I had to ring him on the phone. And he was a psychotherapist. Amazing, he had all these skills. But if I didn't get that, it was like 12 weeks. I would have been a basket case because he actually, you know, it's so emotional, all these words, there's lots of different emotions there. But, and I thought, I've got this, it's okay, I'll just get on with life. And that's when you, when I think you would say, it's like we just store it, it just comes into the body somewhere. I thought, no, I've got to do something. And yeah, I'll go get kinesiology and things if I need, and I know that when I need it, it's like, I can't solve this by myself. You know,
I think it comes back to that community thing, isn't it? It's like we don't have to do it completely on our own, and there are times when we need to stick a hand up and say, I need help with this.
Yeah. And there's that people, yeah, and that awareness, right?
Yeah.
So what's next now? Okay, I wanna go with this question. So I honored so much your vulnerability in writing this, and as you have done hundreds and probably thousands of people by now with your book, and it gave me great hope for me and, you know, others, just the bravery. But what's next for Karen? Like, are you writing? I'm assuming, I know you're editing for other people, but are you writing another book now?
Yeah, I am, but it's not a memoir.
No.
It's comedy. I'm writing comedy.
Really?
Yeah, and I like that.
Yeah. That doesn't surprise me. It doesn't surprise you that you would write comedy at all. Yeah.
No, I do have a fairly awful sense of humour, so.
Yeah.
It's funny. It's almost like that shame, guilt, and Martin Bryant had to come out first. Yeah. I had to get that out and be able to let go of all of that before I could actually just sit down and write for the pure joy of it again.
Yeah, wow. So when is that being published, or are you still writing it, or?
It's a series. I've got a whole heap of little bits and pieces. And today while I was swearing, and you know when you're painting a ceiling and you're like that and you think, oh.
Yeah, no, I don't paint ceilings because I would be swearing, yeah.
Yeah, this is why you pay someone else to do it. But had I done that, I wouldn't have had the epiphany I had today, which is how to bring all of those pieces together, and that all of these little bits I've been writing are actually part of this funny little coffee table book. So when I'm ready, you'll be the first to know.
Oh, I want to read that. I want to read that at all. So is there any other, you know, you want to share with here today, like about anything at all, about the book, about your new book, about healing, about the sanctuary?
Look, if you want to sponsor Rainbow Animal Sanctuary, look us up on Facebook. Yes. We're at rainbowanimalsanctuary.com. Have a chat to us. We're open to ideas. We're just in the process now of beginning the journey of creating a board of governance. Wow. So that we've become a .org, which means that you can make donations and claim it back in your tax. Mm. So that's important because a lot of people want to be able to claim money back in their tax, and we get that. So we're just starting that process now, which I've been a bit slow to do that because it's a horrible process. But we're at that point now where we're clearing up. It's taken a while to get really clear in, okay, we want to buy land, we want to create a sanctuary. What does that look like? So now that we're at that point where we get what it looks like, and we've got a network of people here just in Hobart, we work with saving greyhounds and kittens and pigs and any animal really, natives.
Anything but humans, yeah. Oh no, you save humans as well, you've already done that, yes.
You know, and it's time, it's definitely, it's time to do that. And because all of that fear and shame and guilt has dropped off, taken the back seat, mm-hmm. I actually feel free to go ahead and do that now without fear of what might happen. So that's it's opened the gate.
Oh, I love that. So we'll want to put the link down below, but is it Rainbow Sanctuary?
RainbowAnimalSanctuary.com.
No AU on the end. It's just a .com at the moment.
You're making me think about that.
We've got to get it wrong because we don't want to go into the other organisation. Well, they're all animals anyway. So
don't AU, there you go, you're right.
Yeah, but just to be sure. And so are you still doing your other trainings, Karen, or is that kind of put to the side now? Because I know you're so busy editing for other people and
We are. Vicky teaches the psychosomatics and I assist with that. And we've got a course coming up in January. Starts January the 2nd. We're running 10 days straight. So,
wow.
Exciting. That's a certificate 3. So that's the body reading we were talking about before. And it's a bit more complicated than that. But, yeah. So.
Wow. And you're teaching practitioners?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah.
A lot of people come just for the healing aspect for themselves, which is brilliant. But if they choose to, they can go on and become practitioners themselves. Yeah. When I did the training, I think it's 2011, I had no intention of being a practitioner. I was halfway through a psychology degree at the time. And I just did it because I knew I needed to do something, and nothing had worked. Nothing had really helped. And that really did. And over time, I did become a practitioner, but a bit like going to Hawaii, I approached it kicking and screaming. This might help. I'm not doing that.
Why do you think we do that? Like, and it's
I don't know, but I've learned to recognise it. And when I really, really want to protest something, I'm like, yep, okay. So I know I have to do it.
Sometimes I think, is it because it's our one of our amazing gifts? So do we kind of have to? Surely it has to be harder than that, you know, to have this gift. Because I know you're an amazing healer, you're an amazing writer. And I just think, but I love the story of, you know, I'll just resist that, you know. And I'm the same in the past. Although, you know, some things we run to, and it's like, yeah, but we get to a point. I guess it's growth. Yeah.
So you see it in your clients and you say, why are you resisting that so hard? And it still makes me laugh because I'm like, yeah, I get that. Yeah. I understand that one. Yeah, it's very funny. Next year I'm going to be doing some, with Vicky's going to be working with me on this one too, and I'm doing some writing workshops with a bit of a twist. So.
Oh, I love that.
Yeah.
Yes. So can you elaborate a bit more on the twist, or is that...
Not yet.
Okay.
Not yet. But the concept is not just come and write for a weekend. What we want to do is actually work with what comes up for you. So it's going to be a combination of therapeutic processes along with the writing. So.
Oh, that sounds amazing. So when are you looking at doing that?
We don't have any dates yet because we're likely to be moving house early in the new year. So we kind of wanted to get that sorted and find the space and see, can we bring in 10 people or 20 people, or what are our capabilities in that space straight away? Because, you know, we're not very patient once we get there. We're going to want to be inviting people in pretty fast. So we're going to get excited and go, yes, let's do this.
but I think, like, and I've watched you both, and, you know, together, when something's right, everything's just, you know, I've talked to Vicky, oh yeah, there's 12 people booked it, or there's 15 booked it. It's like,
yeah,
of course there is, you know, and for both of you, I know you both teach in those, or you support as well, and now you've got, you know, this whole other arm of your purpose going on as well. So okay, so where can we, I don't know if there's any questions, does anybody have any questions they want to ask? I have to go over to Facebook just to see normally, but if anybody's on the webinar and they have any questions to ask Karen, I do have a question about the writing process, if I can, while I go and check over here. So you use Tom Burke's method. And you've already written a book before, haven't you, or published? So that was the first. Okay. So what, and have you tried writing and other methods at all before you? Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, I trained as a commercial copywriter in radio, and I did a Diploma of Arts in professional writing and editing, and I've written for print. So I can write all sorts of different things, but to sit down and write a book is a different kettle of fish again. It's quite a different thing. And the enormity, just in word-wise, volume-wise, of that scared me a bit, because I initially learnt on 30-second radio commercials, you're talking maximum 70 words.
Oh, wow.
Unless you talk really, 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 really fast, you know.
Okay.
So what a big shift.
Yeah, so what are three top tips then? So, I mean, and I know I've said to you, I've got the title of my book and then said it to you, and then just you won't hear from me again because I'm kind of over here. Not in shame that I haven't started it. I'm just like, no, the time's going to be ready. So what are three tips that you can tell people who are ready to tell their story or just write? You know, what would you tell them to get started?
If you really think your writing sucks and you just go, I can't do it, I don't know what to do, use the record function on your phone. We've all got audio record on our phones.
Yeah.
And tell the story. Speak it instead for a bit and then listen back and see how the story is when you speak it rather than type it. And then transcribe it, play it, and type it up on your computer and then read it back to yourself. And another handy thing, if you don't want to do that, but you're okay with the typing or the writing, once you've got it in Microsoft Word, or the Apple Macs do it too, they have a function now where you can play it and the computer will read the document to you. So you can get a sense of, it's not the same as a human. You don't get, you know, the inflections and the emotions and the big pauses and all of that. But you get an idea of, actually, that's not bad, or, gee, that's really crap. But it's finding a method that works better for you. It's finding what suits you. I write using Tom Bird's method. He refers to it as contacting your divine author within, which really is just your soul getting to write without your brain interrupting the process and saying, that's not interesting, that's not how you write, that's a wrong word. So your brain's like parked over there for a little while, so your heart and soul can just go, phew. And if you want to have a play with that, go to tombird.com, and he has a meditative intro which gets you into that space, and a 1-hour soundtrack which you can download for free. So there's that's there, and it costs you nothing to have a play with that.
And then busting through the resistance. Give me a tip of doing busting through the resistance.
Well, and this is one of the things that we teach, is when the emotions are high and the resistance is high, is to get up out of your chair and move your body. You know, it might be simply getting your arms up over your head, moving your arms, moving your feet, moving your body, and breathing really deeply right down into your pelvis, not here. Just shallow breathing, a lot of people do, but really pulling your breath right down to your pelvis and then slowly releasing. And so you're actually getting back in your body instead of being in that reactive state. Because when you're in that state of resistance, you tend to be reacting. It's an emotional reaction, which, as we're talking about before, is generally lightly coming from something that's happened earlier in life that wasn't pleasant. You may not even be consciously aware of, so it's hard to, but you know, just get up, move, breathe, and then have another go.
There's always, and then, you know, and I can't even speak right now. No, it's like, but we are not going to get out of here alive, right? We're here, you know, we'll be here for a long time, but it's kind of just taking that risk. And that's probably what I got so much about from your book, and just so inspiring. Yeah. Like, what are we here to risk? What was there to risk? I don't know, some, you know, and the way that you move through all of that, and it was kind of like, I pictured you just go, oh well, it's out the window now, that you know, I don't, all the shame, not all the shame, it's just like, well, who else can write it but me? And I've done it, and it's inspiring, and it's helping, and I'm on to my next thing, you know, still honouring
and being real too, you know. There's no, when I say that, the shame and the guilt that's gone out the window. You know, there are still triggers. There will still be moments that come up or events that's like, whoa, that might knock me off my perch for a little while. But they're not the, they don't have the power in my life that they did. Yeah. They don't have the power to stop me being who I really am, to stop me exploring and playing with writing or talking to you. You know, a year ago, if you'd said, come and talk to me, I would have just gotten embarrassed and awkward and said no. I wouldn't know what to say. What would I do? I'd be like,
That's, you're coming, well, we all, you're not even coming from here. You're coming from here, you know, and even further down. It's just like, it's just a, you know, just having a conversation. And I mean, it's inspiring. Yeah. And I think what, when you were saying, you know, you still have, it still comes, you still get triggered, but the recovery period's smaller.
You know? Yeah.
Okay, I'm over there. Oops. Okay, on to the next one.
Absolutely.
Yeah, we don't have to.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. So give me a little shout out. I'm going to put, where can we buy your book? I'm going to put the link below and on this recording and then back on Facebook. But can you tell us where to buy your book?
Sure. I'd go to Amazon for the ebook.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And if you live outside of Australia, that's probably a good place to go for the paperback. But Amazon don't print in Australia. So if you buy the paperback in Australia via Amazon, it can take weeks to arrive.
Right.
So I would suggest Booktopia.
Yes.
Or an Australian or another Australian supplier, but I find Booktopia pretty good.
Okay.
For the paperback.
Beautiful. And but we can't get it from your website, can we? Or do you have a link over to no?
No, on my website, which is karencollier.com. Mm. I just have the link to Amazon and Booktopia.
Okay, cool. So even if we can just go to your website and then we can link out somewhere. Yeah, beautiful.
Yep.
So karencollier.com.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You can fill your Christmas stocking with books on my website because you'll find a few of the books I've edited in the last few months up there as well. So
I saw that. More amazing people and stories. And
yeah, I've got to update it. There's four more to go on there at the moment. So
wow.
Better get my skates on, eh?
Better get your people to get that on there. So, well, thank you, Karen. It's 9:30. Look at that. Time flies when you're having fun. Thank you so much for coming on and giving of your time and sharing your beautiful wisdom with us. It's been beautiful. I love it.
Thank you, Luann. It's been gorgeous. Thank you for thinking of inviting me.
Wow, we took us, 3 weeks, but we got there. But, yeah, you're welcome. And you did have to wait for me to read the book. So I think I booked you in months and months ago, and I went, oh, yes. Okay, much love to you and love to Vicky as well, and all the best for the rainbowanimalsanctuary.com.
Thank you.
Okay. Bye. Bye-bye.
Bye.